Hollywood Effects Masters, next from TLC.
Hollywood Effects Masters. On this episode, we'll take a behind-the-scenes look at motion picture firepower as we examine the weapons of Hollywood.
We'll meet the professionals responsible for arming the movies with an arsenal of weapons. We'll talk to a veteran Hollywood weapons master who'll show how he trains actors to handle a variety of firearms and find out how a movie shootout is staged and filmed. All this and more on Hollywood Effects Masters.
Stick around.
To create high-powered excitement in an action film or in a Western, weapons are the main ingredient. Weapons are as essential to an action film as the Hollywood stars who wield them. Today's movies require a large variety of weapons, from the smallest handgun to the largest rocket launcher. Where do filmmakers find these weapons? Stembridge Gun Rentals has been supplying weapons to the movies since the early 1920s. Here's Sid Stembridge.
Basically, with most motion pictures, the way they start out at the outset of the film, a prop master usually is the person that we would deal with initially. He is in charge of all the hand props on the show, being the guns, swords, knives, jewelry, all different types of things like that. Most of the companies do want a different look, a film company, such as Terminator 2.
The James Cameron science fiction epic featured this unique shotgun carried by Arnold Schwarzenegger. But as Sid Stembridge tells us, the weapon was custom made for him.
This is what an original 1887 lever action shotgun looks like. This is what the Terminator 2 shotgun started out as. This idea came from the production company themselves to use this type of weapon. They wanted us to cut it down, make it work better, make it lighter, easier to function, so that Arnold could use it continuously on the set. And so this is the start. And this is the finished look. The barrel's been cut down to a legal length, but it's been lightened also. Loop's been put here for Arnold to be able to twirl it. This is also extra put on here so that he would have more to grasp when he was twirling it. In some scenes he used it like this, in other scenes he had just a basic loop. There are three different shotguns that we have that we built for three separate occasions on the show. And this is one of them.
As you can see, director James Cameron utilized the shotgun's new, improved modifications to enhance the scene.
Payback time.
Also making its presence felt in the movie Predator was this Gatling gun. Here's Stembridge's Larry Merrill.
This is a very famous gun here.
It's a General Electric minigun. It's a real gun from the Vietnam era. It shoots up to 6,000 rounds per minute. Jesse Ventura used it out there in the jungle.
And as Jesse Ventura's minigun in Predator shows, Hollywood's appetite for greater firepower is insatiable. Guns are dangerous, potentially lethal weapons, and they have to be handled properly. So, whenever filmmakers use firearms, they call on the weapons master. Today's movie makers know the dangers of working with automatic weapons. The safety of the cast and crew in any scenes using firearms is the responsibility of the weapons master. For Terminator 2, the Stembridge facility not only supplied the weapons, they also trained the actors who used them. Weapons master Sid Stembridge.
Arnold Schwarzenegger on Terminator 2 did not come into our facility here. We worked with him on the set many times, and Jim Cameron did come in. We did a firing sequence with Linda Hamilton outside of our shop. When we start with an actor that has not fired before or an actor that has fired some but is not that familiar with the situation, we will take them out to a firing range. They really learn the basics of handgun safety and control, how to fire, how to reload, how to do all that stuff. So we did that with Linda Hamilton. She was very good, did a real good job at that.
Here's one of Hollywood's top weapons masters, Danny Sprague.
Before I hand a gun to an actor or extra on the set, I just run him through the function of the gun, make sure he understands everything. Most of the blanks that we use, the bulk of them, can be dangerous out to 20 feet. Flame, hot gases, and in some cases wads, fire from the muzzle. So we make him aware of that. Any, you know, 20 feet and beyond, anywhere he points that when he's firing is dangerous. You have brass ejecting hard out to the right side at different angles, different guns, throw them out different ways. And the barrel's gonna be hot when he's through. And the number one thing is when the action's over, when he hears cut, finger off the trigger, barrel to the ground, freeze till we get there to get the gun from him, clear it. Like I say, most of the blanks that we use are dangerous 20 feet beyond the muzzle. So anytime you want to encroach on that distance, get closer. We have half loads, quarter loads, and there's also a load we call suicide load that absolutely nothing comes out the end. As far as the distance, as far as pointing a gun at somebody, the cast and crew, they're right down in it all the time. And you have to figure it out, cover people, face shields, fernie pads. Basically, we're there on the set to give the director the safest way to get the action he wants to see. This is one of my favorite machine guns, if not my favorite. It's a Thompson 1921 model, 50-round drum, and it's just got a great flame. Really looks good on camera.
Movie guns are no less dangerous than real weapons. That's why a weapons master is always on the set to make sure that each firearm is handled properly. When we return, we'll take a look at some of Hollywood's high-tech weapons.
A master of ancient wisdom.
Every aspect of
their gods were to be found in the elements of nature.
Today's audiences are not content to see the same old weapons used over and over again. Weapons specialists are constantly challenged to create new, high-tech firearms in order to satisfy demanding directors and action-hungry audiences. Director George Lucas ushered in a new era of high-tech weaponry with his 1977 blockbuster, Star Wars. For the memorable confrontation between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Darth Vader, the experts at Lucas's effects facility, Industrial Light and Magic, created futuristic swords called lightsabers.
Your power's a weak, old man.
You can't win, Darth. If you strike me down, I shall become more.
Here's visual effects supervisor and ILM alumnus, Harrison Ellenshaw.
The lightsabers themselves were a bit of a problem because the original intent was to take these sticks and put front projection material on them and shine lights on them and do them practically, do them for real, do them in the camera. Well, it didn't work. They saw the first set of dailies and it looked like sticks with front projection material on it, and it wasn't terribly magical. However, they found that it provided a wonderful guide to go in and isolate that area and then just add a bit of animation to it, change the color, That way, now, since you're doing it in post-production, you could have the bad guys red and the good guys blue. And as a result, it really worked in their favor. However, one day, I'm told that they came out on the set and nobody could find the lightsabers, could find the sticks to use, the props. So George said, well, it doesn't matter, just kind of pretend you're fighting and just fight there, which looked fine and everybody's very happy knowing they could add something later. But later on, it's a horrific problem because now people have to imagine where the lightsaber goes. So those were very difficult shots to accomplish. But you couldn't tell looking at the film now which are the ones with the sticks and which ones without the sticks.
Commander, may I borrow that formidable looking sidearm of yours?
The earliest high-tech weapons were seen in science fiction movies like Forbidden Planet. The ray gun that Leslie Nielsen used in this scene looks more like a modified hairdryer than an instrument of destruction. Until Star Wars, filmmakers relied on primitive weapons like this.
You understand the mechanism?
A simple blaster.
These high-tech weapons used in the Michael Jackson feature Moonwalker are anything but simple. Here's Sid Stembridge to tell us how he modified a contemporary assault rifle and gave it a futuristic look.
This type of weapon was picked by the company to be used. This is called an HK-94. And what we did, this is the beginning of it, and they were to put a whole shell around it to have it work as a futuristic type weapon. So it started like this, and it ended up looking basically. This is what was used in Moonwalker as one of the futuristic guns. These were machine guns that were set up. This plastic casing was all built by a special effects fabrication company with our help showing them what exactly had to be done to make sure the gun would function properly during the taking.
From futuristic laser guns to turn-of-the-century pistols, the Stembridge Arsenal has handled Hollywood's weapons needs for over 70 years.
The beginning of Stembridge Gun Rentals started in about 1920, approximately. My father's uncle, James Sidney Stembridge, started the business with C.B. DeMille. And for the motion picture industry, they knew there was going to be and was a need for weapons of all types. So my dad's uncle started collecting firearms and has come to this.
The Stembridge gun collection has, in fact, grown to be one of the largest in the world, featuring a wide variety of rare museum-quality weapons. Here's Stembridge weapons master Larry Merrill.
You'll notice over here racks of military rifles. We have each specific model in depth, maybe a couple of hundred. 1873 trapdoor, Springfields, Krags, Lebels, Mausers, in depth to supply military movies. These are U.S. military rifles from, let's see, the date on this is 1840. It's called a Hall, H-A-L-L, carbine. These were issued to the U.S. military in 1840.
Stembridge weapons have appeared in countless films over the years, like The Alamo with John Wayne and Glory with Matthew Broderick. Larry Merrill explains how such weapons are first acquired.
Many of these guns were acquired between the 20s and the 30s when they were considered curios or actually almost junk, and they were quite affordable. Today, many of these guns are museum quality, and they just cannot be replaced.
Whether it involves ray guns or six shooters, Hollywood loves a gun battle. When we return, we'll find out how Hollywood stages a movie shootout.
Hey, open up! I want that white thing.
New white one.
Movie shootouts may look wild and reckless, but every move is carefully worked out before the cameras roll. This ensures that realistic gun battles only appear dangerous. Here's pyrotechnics expert Greg Hendrickson to show us how a squib was used in our opening sequence.
This is what we call a blood hit. So when the man is shot, he will bleed instead of just tearing the clothing. Basically what a squib is, it's a flat explosive charge that explodes this way. So So it lays on a fabric like this. The explosion will go up and tear the fabric. So what we'll do with the fabric is we will soften it up slightly, sand it down or scrape it with a knife to take some of the integrity away from it so it breaks a little bit easier. Right now what we're doing is preparing the wardrobe for the opening scene of this.
A leather patch is then placed over the squid. This will protect the actor from any injury resulting from the explosion. Greg then explains how the charge is detonated.
The squib is electrically fired. I'll be standing back behind, off camera, battery in hand, and at the appropriate time, we'll push the button. No harm will actually come to our actor. However, it will look like he's been shot quite effectively.
Action!
Essential elements in movie gunplay include special effects like this squib. Proper weapon selection, like these Thompson submachine guns from the movie The Untouchables, also enhance the realism of a movie shootout.
You all right?
When it comes to movie warfare, choosing the right weapon is essential. But it's also important that a gun battle sounds like a gun battle. Capturing the sound of gunfire on film involves far more than just placing a mic in front of the weapon itself. Expert technicians are responsible for giving audiences the right bang for their buck.
Violence!
Most of the gunfire you hear in a film is recorded long after the principal photography is wrapped. Here, military advisor Dale Dye and a sound crew are recording gunfire for the movie Last of the Mohicans. Let's find out how the sound of black powder musket fire was recorded for this film. Here's Dale Dye.
Now, what we're doing here today is picking up sounds, specific sounds, sounds of flintlock weapons going off, that sort of thing. We're picking that up in post-production for Last of the Mohicans.
Here's sound man Lon Bender.
We're trying to achieve the realistic sound quality so the audience can experience what it's like to either be with the firing line or be with the receiving troops that are being fired upon. In order to do that, we need to have separate recordings of what it's like at both ends. You can't do that on a movie set. You have to do that later once you've been able to look at the movie. And that's why we go to great lengths to separate the shooters from the incoming area. We use six different microphones linked up to three different recorders, two of which were recording the shooters, and those were dynamic microphones, and one stereo pair was downrange, which was recording the bullet whiz-bys. We're using three different recorders here so we can have separation of the whiz-bys as well as the shooters on the line, because we need to have uncontaminated material to lay in against picture in a motion picture situation. Being able to get out afterwards in post-production with the point of view of looking at the film, you know what you need to get, and you can manipulate it in the editing room later.
Pistol shooter on the line, full cock, aim in.
Guns aren't the only weapons that Hollywood action movies rely on to create excitement. When filmmakers want to be on the cutting edge, they call on knife specialists. Joe Lombardi has been providing weapons to the movies for over 30 years. His specialties include edged weapons, and Joe is one of the few experts who use a knife gun.
Ross Taylor, an old-timer, made the first knife gun there is. We actually shoot a knife like this, which you see, it's a real steel knife, out of a gun.
The knife gun uses air pressure to shoot the knife at a target, which is often human.
At 25 feet, we can put it right into the fellow's chest. He has a steel plate with a balsa wood, and it goes underneath his chest, and we can actually stick it in straight.
Like the knife gun, the blood knife is used in films to make stabbings look realistic. A blood knife adds that extra degree of authenticity to scenes that need credible-looking close-ups. Here to demonstrate is blood knife expert Ben Robertson.
The blood knife can be fixed several ways. You can have the blood squirting out from the bottom here, or you can have it squirting out from the top. It depends on what you want to do. From the tip, if you're going to do a stabbing, or from the back, if you're just going to do a simple slice.
A piece of surgical tubing is attached to the knife. The actor can control the flow of the blood by squeezing the surgical tube. A combination of corn syrup and food coloring is used to simulate blood. This solution is then poured into the surgical tubing. When the tubing is squeezed, it looks as if the knife is actually drawing blood from its victim.
Stop!
Many different types of weapons were used in Francis Ford Coppola's Apocalypse Now. Weapons specialist Joe Lombardi, who has worked with Coppola on many of his films, tells us about this scene.
Francis decided that he wanted 10,000 arrows to go through the air. And I told him, we can't make 10,000 arrows. He said, what is the most arrows you guys ever shot? I said, we shoot 100 arrows. And a man called Horst, they shot about 300 arrows. And first he said, I want 1,000 arrows. Then he said, I want 10,000 arrows. I said, we got to make the arrows, right? We had nothing to make the arrows, so we used bamboo. We cut bamboo. Luckily, there's rubber plantation there, so we dip rubber tips on them, and we use paper feathers on these things. And they were made out of bamboo. Tried to get them straighter, and that was a problem. Then finally, I had to shoot these through the air. And the shot you see when the boat's coming down, and you can see it all over the water, and we shot 6,500 arrows at one time through the air. And the greatest part about it, he says, how did it look? And I said, no, it looks like a bunch of Chinese chopsticks coming through there.
Weapons are a signature element of American action films. Just remember, even movie firearms are dangerous, and they have to be handled by professionals. That's a wrap. See you next time on Hollywood Effects Masters.
How does the death of an aging star give life to countless new ones? Find out from The Practical Guide to the Universe, next on TLC.